Armstrong Machine Works presents...
Yeah, you. Come here. You do know that the energy used in industrial processes comes from three basic types of fuel: solid, liquid, and gas? Oh, you know that. Then you probably know that with fuel getting costlier, the cost of manufacturing is also going up. Good, you know that too. I'll bet you also know that much of the fuel used in industry goes for the generation of steam used in various steam systems. And that industrial people, in an effort to save energy and get the most out of their fuel dollars, have taken steps to eliminate obvious steam losses. Leaks to atmosphere, uninsulated pipes, dirt in steam equipment, faulty components, and steam traps. I figured you knew that. But here's one you might not know. There are barriers to heat transfer that are very often overlooked. Condensate and air layers in heat exchangers, and burned product or other films on heat exchange surfaces. Barriers that waste energy. Did you know that? That's what I thought. Well, here's Mr. Otho Ulrich, Director of Field Engineering for Armstrong Machine Works. Let's hear what he has to say about all this.
When water is boiled to produce steam, certain amounts of non-condensable gases are released. These gases include oxygen and carbon dioxide and are generally referred to as air. Some of the gases enter the boiler dissolved in the feed water, while oxygen is, of course, part of the water itself. In addition to the air released when water boils, there's always air in the system during equipment startup. When the supply steam to any equipment is turned off, the residual steam in the space collapses, causing a vacuum. Air enters the steam space through the seals, the joints, traps, glands, and through vacuum breakers. Before the equipment can be heated to operating temperature again, this air must be evacuated and replaced by steam. Conventional drainage systems are not capable of quickly discharging large quantities of air. Let's consider the behavior of air and steam during the startup period. There are two factors that basically determine the steam flow and distribution within a heat exchanger: the shape of the steam space and the location of the steam inlet and condensate drain. In this heat exchanger, steam enters through the inlet at the left and pushes the air in front of it to the drain at the right. If the steam trap in the drain line is capable of venting a sizable quantity of air, the steam will quickly fill the steam space, producing a fast and uniform temperature rise. The same steam trap arrangement could be effective if the steam inlet were at the top of a vertical heat exchanger and the drain were at the bottom. In this type of heat exchanger, the steam inlet and condensate drain are on the same end of the steam space. The steam pushes the air to the right side of the space where it becomes trapped, forming a cold spot on the heat exchange surface. Some of the air mixes with the steam, and the rest forms a cold pocket, resulting in uneven heating. To remove the air from this space, a thermostatic air vent should be installed at the end of the heat exchanger, opposite the steam inlet and condensate drain. We will discuss the operation of air handling steam traps and air vents after we consider the effects of air and steam. The pressure of the supply steam to any heat exchanger is determined by the temperature pressure curve of pure steam. For example, steam at 50 PSIG has a temperature of 297 degrees Fahrenheit. If a process requires a temperature of 297 degrees Fahrenheit. The operator sets his control valve for 50 pounds gauge pressure. Air-steam mixtures are cooler than pure steam, as shown in this table. Dalton's law of partial pressures states that in a mixture of gases and vapors, the total pressure of the mixture equals the sum of the partial pressures of all of the gases or vapors. Thus, a mixture of 3 parts steam and 1 part air at 100 pounds absolute pressure produces the equivalent temperature of saturated steam at 75 pounds absolute, or 307 degrees Fahrenheit. The temperature of saturated steam at 100 pounds absolute pressure is nearly 328 degrees Fahrenheit, a difference of over 20 degrees. Now, if this loss of a few degrees were the only effect of air in the steam, most processes could easily compensate by raising the supply pressure if the operator were aware of the low temperature. Non-condensable gases are carried with the steam towards the heat exchange surface. Unable to condense, these gases form an insulating layer between the steam and the heat exchange surface. To overcome the insulating effect of this layer of air, steam pressures must be increased or process times lengthened. Both of these alternatives are costly. Air is one of the best heat insulators in use today. Insulating material merely confines air to minute pockets to restrict its natural convections. The heat conductivity of air is 0.2, compared with 5 for water and 340 for cast iron. The iron is 1,700 times as good a heat transfer agent as air. Therefore, a film of air, 1/100th of an inch thick, provides the same barrier to heat transfer as a wall of cast iron 17 inches thick. In fact, as little as 0.5% by volume of non-condensable gas in the steam can reduce the heat transfer efficiency by as much as 50%. This illustration shows a cross-section of a heat exchange surface for a process requiring a product temperature of 210 degrees Fahrenheit. As steam reaches the surface, it gives up its latent heat and condenses, leaving a film of condensate. Air in the steam collects with the condensate on the inside of the heat exchange surface. If the heat exchanger is immersed in the product, a layer of water or burned product may form on the outside of the heat exchange surface. To overcome the heat transfer barriers and obtain a product temperature of 210 degrees Fahrenheit, the supply steam must be set at 15 pounds gauge, or 250 degrees Fahrenheit. There is a 40 degree temperature loss that results from the insulating layers on the heat exchange surface. If it were possible to reduce the thickness of the condensate and air on the inside of the surface by 1/2, the steam pressure could be lowered from 15 to 10 pounds gauge, or 240 degrees Fahrenheit. This figure shows an autoclave used for sterilizing hospital instruments. The process requires that a temperature of 228 degrees Fahrenheit be maintained for a predetermined length of time. Normally, the required temperature can be reached by applying 20 pounds absolute to the steam inlet. However, if the steam is mixed with 25% air, the temperature would only reach 213 degrees Fahrenheit, and sterilization would not be assured. Many industries can benefit from installing special air handling devices and other evacuating components on their equipment. In the textile industry, such devices were installed on stacks of dry cans. Initial warm-up time was immediately reduced from an average of 90 minutes to less than 10 minutes. The improved performance resulted in a saving of 4,800,000 BTUs per day in a 2 dry can stack. This saving is the equivalent of 32 gallons of fuel oil or 5,330 cubic feet of natural gas per day. In the food processing industry, one of the most consistent problems is removing air from jacketed kettles and pans. One small pan was fitted with an air removal device. The result was to reduce the cooking time by 2 minutes per batch and to save approximately 59,500 BTUs per batch. When a large jacketed pan was similarly fitted, the cooking time was reduced by more than 10 minutes per batch, saving 18 pounds of steam for each batch processed. Because of the reduced process time, production was increased by 8 batches per day. One of the major factors in removing air from steam spaces is the location of the air vents. The air must be evacuated quickly to prevent mixing with the incoming steam and to achieve uniform temperature. And obviously, the place to install the air vent is where the air collects. Usually, the air vent will be elevated above the highest part of the steam space to minimize the liquid carryover through the vent. Air removal devices use thermostatic elements, like those used in thermostatic steam traps. They operate on the balanced pressure principle and follow the steam temperature-pressure curve. Air in the steam reduces the temperature of the space surrounding the thermostatic element, causing the valve to open. As the steam-air mixture is evacuated, the temperature at the thermostatic element rises, causing the valve to close. Now, the amount of steam that's lost in this discharge is insignificant when compared to the resultant temperature rise in the steam system. Thermostatic air vents may be separate units, as shown here, or may be incorporated into a steam trap, as in the floating thermostatic trap, as shown here. Now, the right unit for a particular heat exchanger depends on the shape of the steam space and the flow pattern from the steam inlet to the drain. Now, although air venting is often overlooked by many engineers, the proper application of air removal devices can provide substantial savings of both steam and time through quicker startups and more efficient equipment operation. Your Armstrong representative can provide specific information on venting air from your production equipment.